Fort Creek tonight. I know we had, like I said earlier, we had a great time this morning. And every once in a while, we get to singing these old songs, and we get lyricosis. I don't know what y'all know what lyricosis is, but that's when you jumble all the words together, and then you can't find out where you're at on the page.
Chronic lyricosis.
Yeah, and me and Robert have it really bad a lot of times. But anyway, this morning we had a great time this morning.
Not being able to read good doesn't help.
Oh, okay. But, you know, Tracy... I think Tracy kind of overdid it this morning coming to church and stuff like that. So y'all make sure you pray for him for the healing and stuff that he's going to need. Brother Clifford Brown's going to be back with us this morning. And tonight. But if you have your bulletin, like Tracy says every morning, but I know sometimes we have some people here at night, pull off that little side thing, put your name on, throw an offering plate. Tracy prays over these things every week. I don't know if y'all know this, but he prays over all these names that are filled out on this little sheet on the side of your bulletin. But I'm going to pray for us, and we're going to keep on singing. Amen. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, dear Lord, just thank you for the day that you've given us, dear Lord. Thank you for being the awesome God that you are. Dear Lord, thank you for being our Savior. You're just an awesome... You're just an awesome... God, dear Lord, that we don't deserve what you give us. Thank you for your mercy and your grace, dear Lord. Just be with Brother Brown and I as he preaches, dear Lord. Just hide him behind the cross. Give him the words to say. Give us open heart, receptive hearts, or receptive minds, dear Lord. Just thank you for everything that you do for us. In Jesus' name, I do pray. Amen.
Isn't it amazing that we love and worship a God so much that we have that kind of passion just talking about him?
Yeah.
It's amazing. Mm-hmm. Y'all stand with us or have a seat, whatever you want to. We're on 447, Trust and Obey.
Let us do his will.
flip over to 483. This is going to be an offertory hymn, Footsteps of Jesus. Here's some old ones here. Katie picked these out tonight.
Footprints of Jesus, let me Well, aren't you glad that his eye is on the sparrow? And of course, the implication of that is he's watching over me. Always take advantage of making truth personal. I like to preach to folks, the Lord's taking care of you, but then make it personal, he's taking care of me as well. He's watching over me. It's good to see you tonight. Thank you for being back. I commend you for still having a Sunday evening service, and I pray that the Lord will use it in your life, and then he will use it for others as well, and can still accomplish his purpose through it. It's been a joy for me to be here this morning, and then look forward to being back tonight. And that beautiful young lady back there is my daughter. I only have one daughter. She's number one. I have a son, but he's junior. He's further down the line. He's the baby of the outfit. But that's my daughter. She's visiting with us from Roanoke, Virginia. And so she came with me today. Susan would have been here, but she always enjoys coming here. But her and her sister and her niece had just got in late last night from a 7-day cruise. And she still had sea legs, I think. She just wasn't able to get here. But I give you her regards, and the next opportunity that presents itself, I'm sure that she'll be with me, and we'll enjoy coming to Fort Creek. But I appreciate your faithfulness, your patience, your prayers, and I pray the Lord uses me in some way to be an encouragement to you. I appreciate your pastor, and continue to pray for his well-being. I know that he's anxious, as all preachers are, to get back in the saddle again and be back doing the things that he loves and the Lord's called him to do. So God bless you, Brother Tracy, and we're going to pray you through, and you'll be back soon. Turn your Bible tonight, and I'm going to be in a familiar passage. In fact, you could probably do as much with this as I can, but I think it's good sometimes just to revisit old familiar friends, just to go back and have a little chat, a conversation, and just be reminded of the good things of the Lord. So I want you to turn tonight to the book of Psalms, and you might even guess the 23rd. One of my favorite Psalms, but then everybody says that. And of course, there's a reason for that. One of the great little chapters, 6 verses long, and yet it is marvelous in its pictures. It's marvelous in its preaching and teaching, and marvelous in its provision. And I pray that the Lord will use it tonight. I want to preach on our sovereign shepherd. Our sovereign shepherd. And as the old black preacher said, just take this as a taproot. Some of you folks know what a taproot is. He'd always start his sermons, this will be our taproot. That's the root that goes deep and makes the plant survive the best. So we'll just dig down here for a few minutes. When I was pastor of the Clearview Baptist Church up in Ringgold, Georgia, many years ago now, we had a man in our church who was in the hospital, been critically ill for several weeks. It was the Christmas season, and he was in ICU and had not been out of bed in many days, had not been conscious in many days. And we were having breakfast. Mindy was at home. Shay was at home. They were young. And we were having breakfast at our house on Christmas Day. And the hospital called. And they said, Preacher Brown, you're needed at the hospital. They said, Mr. Edwards has just died. And so I got my business together, went on up to the hospital, went on up to the ICU, and met with the family and talked with them a few minutes and heard the story. And then I went back in the ICU unit where his body still was, and some of the family was back there. And while I was back there, a nurse called me off to the side, and she said, "Preacher Brown, I never saw anything like I saw a little while ago." She said, I wouldn't have believed it if somebody told me, but I saw it. She said, "I'd been in Mr. Edwards' room, and he was laying on the bed like he has been for days, just lifeless in itself. And she said, I walked out of the room for a few minutes, and when I came back in," she said, "I found him standing by the bed." She said he literally was standing by the bed, said he didn't have a stitch of clothes on him. He was standing up and said he quoted the 23rd Psalm perfectly. He quoted these six verses, and then she said, "I helped him back into bed. He lay down in the bed, and he went to be with the Lord." Isn't that an amazing picture? A saint on his way home, and the last thing that he found comfort in was the 23rd Psalm. A bit unique. And I wouldn't have believed it myself, and the nurse said as much. I wouldn't have believed it if I hadn't have witnessed it myself. Well, could a man or woman have a better place to pillow their dying head than in the 23rd Psalm? Can you recommend somewhere that would be any better than this particular place? The great Baptist preacher Charles Haddon Spurgeon, he called it the pearl of the Psalms. The pearl of the Psalms. 19th century preacher and commentator J.J. Stuart Perrone observed, "There is no psalm in which the absence of all doubt, misgiving, fear, and anxiety is so remarkable." He just described tranquil peace, didn't he? Alexander McLaren said, and I agree with him on this, he said, "The world could spare many a large book better than this sunny little psalm. It has dried many tears. It has supplied the mold into which many hearts have poured their peaceful faith." I like that. Pastors have used it to comfort people down through the years who are going through severe trials and personal experiences, suffering, illness, and, as I've already mentioned, the very hour of death itself. For some, the words of this psalm have been the last that they have uttered in this life. And I've been with families when we've stood around the bed and read the psalm together, quoted the psalm together, and trusted in the blessing and the benefit of this wonderful psalm. It's a great psalm. If ever a psalm could stand almost on a single line, if you could pick a single line out of any psalm and it would stand on it, it would be this psalm, and the one line that would be found to me would be in verse number 1. And that's what I want you to notice tonight is in Psalm 23, verse number 1, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want." The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. Now, this is my personal belief. You can take issue if you will, and we'll still be brothers or sisters. You can think otherwise. But I personally believe that David wrote this psalm not as a young shepherd, but as an old shepherd, as an older man. He, of course, became the king of Israel, but he never lost his shepherd heart. All of his days, David had a shepherd heart. And I believe that when he wrote this psalm, I just pictured in my mind that somehow he's looking back across the years and he's thinking about the faithfulness of God. He's thinking about the provision of God. He's thinking about all that the Lord has done in his life, and he writes this psalm out of that rich experience that he had with the Lord. He doesn't brag. He doesn't insinuate. He doesn't suggest his life of faithfulness, but he sure does brag on the Lord and his faithfulness to him down through the years. So I think it was the psalm of experience that caused him, his own life experience with the Lord, and he gave testimony to that. Now, David would do that in other psalms as well. For instance, in Psalm 37, I believe it is, David said, I have been young, but now I'm old. I understand more about that every day. He said, I have been young, now I'm old. And he said, I've never seen the righteous forsaken, nor his seed begging bread. That was a testimony of experience. It wasn't just what he heard at some conference. It was out of a lifetime of living. And he said, I've never seen the righteous forsaken, nor his seed begging bread. Well, I believe it's out of his experience that he wrote this psalm. And it speaks to our hearts all the time, down through the years, thousands of years. People have drawn inspiration, strength, and courage from this particular psalm. So look at it with me tonight. I'm just going to read that verse 1, and then we'll allude to the rest of them a little bit along the way. But in verse 1, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. A little boy misquoted that. He said, the Lord is my shepherd, and I don't want anything else. That's all I want. And we could say that just as well. The Lord is my shepherd. The Lord is our sovereign shepherd. Let me unpack that verse with us for just a few minutes tonight and see what it is that is so rich and so sweet that comes out of this psalm. I want you to notice the words of the psalm in that verse for just a minute. I want you to notice, first of all, it says, the Lord, the Lord. It did not say a Lord. It does not say any Lord. It does not say some Lord, but it says the Lord. There is one God and only one God. Back in the book of Deuteronomy, we hear those words that come from Moses. Hear, O Israel. The Lord our God is one God. Now let me tell you tonight, or I don't need to tell you, but let's remind us, we have never needed that message more than we need that message today. There is a wave of the doctrine or the teaching of the philosophy, whatever you want to call it, of plurality, pluralism, that would suggest that there's not just one, but there's many. You'll hear that teaching. There's not just one way to heaven, but there's many ways to heaven. And my truth is my truth, and your truth is your truth, and you believe what you'd like to believe, and I believe what I like to believe, and you trust in your God, and I'll trust in mine. But I want to tell you, the Bible said there is one Lord and one only. And we need to have some meetings and preaching and conferences where we go back to Paul's strategy in Acts 17 when he saw all the gods, all the idols displayed at Mars Hill. And there was that one pedestal that didn't have a god on it. And he said, what's this for? And they said, well, we might have missed one of the others. And we didn't want to offend any of the gods. Paul said, let me just tell you about that God. And he preached about this God that we find in the book of Psalms and all through the scripture. He told them about the Lord, and he preached to them the truth about the Lord, and he shared with them the gospel. You see, our faith is an exclusive faith. It does not leave room for other gods and other ways and other means. Now, that doesn't mean we have to be mean. It doesn't mean we have to be disrespectful. It doesn't mean that we have to run over people. But I want to tell you, we do have to stand firm and stand sure and stand on our convictions that there is only one Lord. Now, he is inclusive. The Lord is inclusive in that all are invited into the family. He is inclusive when he says that all have sinned and come short of the glories of God. He is inclusive when he says that all need a Savior and that we can only be saved through Jesus Christ. In that sense, he is inclusive. All are invited, but he is exclusive as to how they may come. And there's only one way, and that is through the Lord Jesus Christ. And you're very familiar with John 14:6, where he said, I am the way, I am the truth, I am the life, and no man comes unto the Father except by me. Now you fool around with that, you mess with that, and you are going to distort the gospel of Jesus Christ. That is the gospel, that salvation is through him and him alone. It is an exclusive message that we get. The Lord. But let me move ahead for a moment. Look at the word Lord. It is the Lord. David said, the Lord is my shepherd. The word Lord, if you look in my Bible, that whole word is capitalized. Lord. And it's the English translation of the great Old Testament personal name for God. It is the name that was first disclosed to Moses way back at the burning bush when the Lord commissioned him to go back to Israel and carry his message. And Moses said, what if they don't hear me? What am I going to tell them then? He said, the Lord said, you tell them I am that I am, and you tell them that I am is the one who has sent you. It is the self-disclosure of who God is. I am that I am. That name is repeated more than 4,000 times in the pages of the Old Testament. The name literally means I am who I am, and it is an inexhaustible name and chiefly refers to God, and as it refers to him, it refers to two primary truths. It refers, first of all, to the fact that God is timeless. It is talking about the timelessness of God. There never was a time when he was not God. There never has been a time when he wasn't around. He's always been around. The timelessness of God. He's always the same in his eternal traits, in his attributes. He was like this yesterday. He will be like he is tomorrow. And he's like he is today. He's always the same. The writer of Hebrews clarified that when he said, Jesus Christ, the same yesterday, today, and forever. He's the same that he always has been. Well, we need to understand that and we need to rely on that. He will be unchanged and unchangeable forever. God does not change. I don't know about you, and I know I date myself when I say stuff like this, but I don't like all this change that's going on. This world's just changing far too quickly for me. I'm a slow starter, it just seems like the world is whirling by, and every day there's a new change, there's a new gimmick, there's a new game, there's a new strategy. I mean, just there's too much. It's just too much. Somebody said nobody likes change. You heard about the pastor that had a scriptural verse over every room in the church, you know, identifying the different Sunday school classes. They said he even had a little sign on the nursery. It said, and we shall all be changed. But you know, even babies don't like to be changed. They cry when you change them. And the truth is, most of us are set in some of our ways, if not all of them, and it's not easy for us to change. But what I'm trying to say to you tonight, and I know I've stressed that, what I'm trying to say to you, in a world of rapid change, and by the way, some of it's good. I understand that. I'm thankful for the good change, but a lot of it is not good. But in a world of rapid change, I'm glad that the one who changes not is the one who stands by me. Amen? Our God does not change, and we can depend on Him. We can lean on Him. We can trust in Him because He never, never changes. He's the same that He always has been. And it is that Lord, that's the one that David said is my shepherd. It is the God who does not change. Anchor yourself to Him, and it'll be better in the journey. But not only is our God timeless and unchanging, but our God is self-sufficient. He's self-sufficient. I get amused sometimes reading stories and hear things about this self-made man. You heard of him, haven't you? The self-made man. When he come into the world, couldn't do a thing for himself. And there's his mom and daddy doing everything for him. They feed him, they bathe him, they change him. And they're there to look after him. They teach him to brush his teeth. They teach him to tie his shoes. They teach him to put his clothes on. Grows up, and they're still teaching him. And then they start him off to school. And teachers for 12 years pour their lives into him. And graduates high school, goes off to college, and then there's more that are poured their life into. And somehow he manages to be successful, and then he declares, I'm a self-made man. When hundreds and thousands of people have poured into his life to enable him to accomplish what he has. Isn't that the world we live in? Isn't that where we are? But God didn't need anybody to do that for him. He didn't need help because he's self-sufficient in and of himself. That is our God. God needs nothing. There's nothing that he needs. He doesn't need wisdom from anybody because he is wisdom. He is wisdom in himself. He needs no power because he is all-powerful. He's omnipotent. He does not need to be worshiped. Hear me on this before you run off and say, what are you talking about? God does not need your worship. We worship Him because He is worthy of our worship. We worship Him because of who He is, not because He is needy. He does not need to be helped. He doesn't even need to be served. It is not because he needs us to serve him. It is because we have the privilege to serve him. He's not accountable to anybody. He answers only to himself. He is self-sufficient in who he is. And that's why I think it was Moses again that wrote those words, God hath done what he pleases. He don't have to ask permission. He just does what he pleases because he is God. And it is that Lord, that is our shepherd. He's the great I am. God revealed himself to Moses as that great I am. He is our wonderful shepherd, and I'm thankful that he is. Every time in the New Testament, well, actually all through the Scripture, by the way, Jesus used that title, I am, all through us. You see that in the book of John. There's a number of times that he uses that very title for who he is. He said, I am the light of the world. He said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. He said, I am the resurrection. He uses that same title. Why? Because he is that same God. He's the second person of the Trinity. He is that same God who is the Lord, our shepherd. And every time he referred to himself as I am, it is associated with a revelation of a need and that he was meeting that need. It is associated with a need that man has and with the fact that he is the one who meets that need. I'm glad we have a shepherd that can meet our needs, aren't you? He's sovereign in who he is. But then he takes up that mantle of being a shepherd. God could have chosen to be whatever he wanted to be, but he chose to be a shepherd. He is our sovereign Lord, capable of meeting every need and any need that we may have. And no one, I think, fits that bill like being a shepherd. We have that debate every once in a while, and especially some of these younger preachers that want to rewrite the script. And they come up with these arguments that if Jesus was born today, if he was here today, he would not be a shepherd, but that he would be a CEO. And they live that out. They sit in their ivory towers and devise their plans and pass them on down to those beneath them, and they run God's church just that way. They emphasize being successful, and successful they seem. They grow the bigger churches, they have the bigger crowds, they write the books and they do the tours and they do all these things. But I think a lot of what we're seeing is going to be like a balloon that gets popped one of these days, because they miss the point of who God is and what he does. CEO, well, yeah, he could be a CEO. But he said, what my people need is not so much a CEO. What they need is a shepherd. And he said he is the shepherd. Jesus came and he said he's the shepherd. He said he's the great shepherd. He's the chief shepherd. He came as the shepherd. No one ever entered this world in more lowly terms than what Jesus did. No one who's ever passed through has lived a life of meager fare like Jesus did. No one's ever been treated like he was in his death, and yet he willingly went all the way, died at the cross, because the sheep were lost and needed a shepherd. The Bible said he looked on the multitudes and he had compassion upon them because they were as sheep without a shepherd. And God sent his son to be the shepherd that the sheep needs. He is our sovereign shepherd. Now, what is the shepherd? You know, a shepherd's work was considered the lowest of all works. Remember when Samuel was sent over there to the house of Jesse to look for the king? The Lord sent him over there and said, you'll find the king, the next king. You'll find him among the sons of Jesse. And so he went over there and he started with the tallest, the oldest, who was naturally the one to receive the birthright and the blessing of that family. And when he looked at Elias, he saw him and he said, surely the Lord's anointed is among us. He made the mistake of thinking for himself and not after God's heart. But after he said, this is surely going to be him, the Lord said, that's not him, scratch him. And he went down through all the sons of Jesse, scratched every one of them. And then he said, is there not more sons? And they said, oh yeah, by the way, Jesse, he said, there is one other, the runt, the youngest, the least. We've sent him over yonder to do the meager work. We've sent him to do the humble work of a shepherd. He's out there with the sheep. And I love what Samuel said. He said, let's just sit down here a while and we'll sit till he comes. We'll wait on him to show up. Didn't do anything. I don't know how long it took him. I don't know how far he was. I don't know what the distance traveled. Somebody had to go tell him. Somebody had to go get him. Somebody had to take over the sheep. But finally they brought him, young David. And when they did, Samuel immediately said, that's him. The Lord said, Samuel, that's him. That's him. You see, he found the shepherd heart, and he knew that was God's choice. But my point is, the shepherd was always the one, usually it was the youngest, and he got the unpleasant assignment of shepherds having to live with the sheep and to be responsible for them. The Bible even said that David was found following the sheep. I heard a preacher say years ago he was following after the sheep. You know what that means, don't you? That means watch your step. If you're following the sheep, you got to watch your step. He was doing the menial task, and yet the Lord called him. The task of caring for the sheep was unending. It was day and night. It was summer and winter, in fair weather and foul. They labored to nourish and guide and protect the sheep. Who in his right mind would ever just choose the vocation of being a shepherd? Do you realize that the shepherd literally had to provide everything for the sheep? I have read where that sheep would graze in a pasture until all the grass was gone. And then they'd just keep grazing until they pulled up the roots and they ate them. But sheep are senseless to be able to find other pastures to graze in. And the shepherd is required to push them on, to move them on. That's why the second verse said, he makes me to lie down in green pastures. He moves us to where the meal is. He takes us to where the food is. They otherwise would just simply die. The sheep have no protective mechanism. You don't read about sheep fighting and all of that. In fact, they're defenseless in every sense. And so the shepherd is needed to protect them. And we could just go on talking about the nature of the sheep and why the shepherd is so important to the sheep. Why so important to the sheep? Do you know what the greatest single skill or gift or ability or the greatest single thing that the shepherd brings to the flock is? Do you know what that is? It's his presence. It's his presence. Because when the shepherd is present, the sheep have everything they need. That's why he said, I shall not want. He knew that the shepherd was going to provide for the sheep. Man, that's just good. The shepherd. Jesus fulfilled that role of being the shepherd of the sheep. And then Jesus died for the sheep. He said, I am the good shepherd in John 10:11. The good shepherd gives his life for his sheep. And the shepherd literally was always willing to die for his sheep. He would die protecting his sheep. John 10:14, Jesus said, I'm the good shepherd. I know my sheep and am known by my own. And as the Father knows me, even so I know the Father. And I lay down my life for the sheep. He died for the sheep. Do you doubt his love for you? Do you doubt the love that God had for us? Do you doubt the love that Jesus had? Doubt no more, because he's the shepherd who died for the sheep. He is our great shepherd, and I praise the God for that. He loved us and gave his life for us. That holy God would condescend to shepherd life so that we might have shepherd love, showed beyond all doubts that he loved us, and it should remove all doubts about the sovereign shepherd, Lord, who loves us. He not only died for us, but he'll display us. He's going to put us on display. The glory of the shepherd is in his flock. His pride is in his flock. His flock is the testimony of who he is. How good a shepherd he is reflected in his flock. And so he takes care of them so that they will be a testimony of his character as the shepherd. Now, if you doubt that, let me share with you Ephesians chapter 2, verse 4 through 7. Paul wrote there, "But God, who is rich in mercy, because of his great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in trespasses, he made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved and raised up together and made sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus." Now listen, listen. "That in the ages to come he might show the exceeding riches of his grace in his kindness toward us in Christ Jesus." The eternal display of the people redeemed by grace is going to be the glorious testimony of who Jesus is. It's going to bear witness to our wonderful Lord, our wonderful Savior. He is our shepherd, our sovereign shepherd. What a wonderful blessing that is. "Well, the Lord is my shepherd." I love that verse. And he goes on to say, "And I shall not want." Notice a couple of verses, and then I'll close. A couple of words that we don't need to omit. And, of course, we could look on the rest of those verses and find a lot to talk about. But look in that first verse again. Look at that little word "is." You know what the meaning of is, don't you? Everybody ought to know what the meaning of is. The little word "is." That's present tense. David wrote maybe 3,000 years ago, "The Lord is my shepherd." I read it tonight, "The Lord is my shepherd." Present tense. A little boy asked his buddy, he was writing some kind of composition. He asked his buddy, he said, "How do you spell rat?" His buddy said, "R-A-T. That's how you spell rat." And the little boy said, "No, not the mousy kind. I mean like right now. How do you spell right now?" Well, I'm here to tell you that the Lord is right now our shepherd. Present tense. Wouldn't it change things if we read the Lord was a great shepherd? Or that even he shall be, but bless his name this very moment. He is my shepherd. Hallelujah. What a Savior. But then I want you to notice another word, and that's another two-letter word, and it's that little word, "my." I love you dearly, but I'm glad he didn't say the Lord is our. Now, he is our shepherd if we're Christians, if we're saved. He is our shepherd. But I want you to know I'm glad I can say he is my shepherd. Can you say that tonight? Can you say honestly that the Lord Jesus is your shepherd? You see, what that word implies and what it says is that we have a personal relationship with him. He's my shepherd. We don't belong to other flocks. We don't belong to other shepherds. We belong to him. He is our shepherd and we are his sheep. It's not our, but it's mine. Do you have such a shepherd in your life? Not only is he sovereign, not only is he shepherd, but let me just lead us to the invitation by saying he's our sufficient shepherd. I shall not want. And that promise is fulfilled in the other five verses of this little psalm. Everything you and I need, the shepherd provides, and it is all kind of laid out in the rest of those verses. Do you know the shepherd tonight? Can you say that he is my shepherd? And because of that, can you say, I shall not? Bring your need to him. He's sufficient to meet every need. Don't always meet it like you think he ought to, or like you want him to, or like you expect him to. But I've trusted him long enough to know that he'll always supply our needs when we trust him. Let's bow together for prayer. Father, I've tried again to exalt you for being our sovereign shepherd. And Lord, I always know that I somehow miss the mark somewhat. But I pray that the Holy Spirit will do what I cannot do. I pray the Holy Spirit will take the conviction of this passage and of this psalm and make it real, make it personal to every person in this room tonight. Especially if there's a person here who cannot say, "The Lord is my shepherd." I pray tonight they'll come to trust the Lord Jesus as the Savior of their life, the shepherd of their life, giving their life totally to him. And I pray tonight, Lord, if there's someone who has a pressing need, whatever it may be, Lord, the sheep are constantly having needs, and there's various needs and all kind of things that goes on in sheep life. But I pray if there's a dear person here tonight that has a need, that they'll run to the shepherd, they'll bring their need to you, and they'll trust you to supply the need, because you promised to David, and you still promise to us, "I shall not want." I pray this tonight in Jesus' name. While we stand together and while we, I think, you're going to play for us, while we wait in the presence of the Lord, if you have a need you need to come for, or even if you're not saved and you need to come and trust the Lord Jesus, I'll stand down front and I'll be glad to pray with you. Don't you love our shepherd? What a wonderful Savior and sovereign he is. Come tonight if you have any need at all while we wait in his presence. Father, we just want to stop a minute and thank you for who you are. Thank you for being our great sovereign shepherd. Thank you for the promises you make that you will supply our needs. You will see us home, as this psalm ends in the last verse. We'll finally be home. And I just pray that you'll help us to realize what blessed people we are to know a shepherd who loves his sheep as you do, who was willing to lay down your life for the sheep, but then you also live for the sheep as well. Lift the burden of every heart, touch every life, those that may be suffering illnesses, I pray you'll touch them with your healing mercies. I pray, Lord, for those that may have lost loved ones recently and grief is still a big part of their life, comfort them and be with them. Father, now dismiss us with your love and grace. Bless us as we go to our resting place, and then should you give us tomorrow, help us to walk this next week thankful and blessed that as your sheep, we have such a shepherd. We pray this tonight in Jesus' name. And everybody said amen, amen and amen. God bless you. Thank you for being here. And you're dismissed.